Thank you. Just before we start the daily routine, the subject matter for late debate has been chosen and is, therefore be it resolved, that the Liberal government's mishandling of the negotiations with nurses at Capital Health will cause the cancellation of important tests and procedures and is putting patient safety at risk. And that has been submitted by the MLA for Pictou East, the member from Pictou East. And do you do the other one too? We'll now proceed with the daily routine. We'll begin with the presenting and reading of petitions. The Honourable Member for Kings North.
Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to table a petition, the operative clause being, whereas we, the citizens of Kings County, Nova Scotia, have not received high-speed internet service, as has been promised to all citizens of Nova Scotia dating back to 2009, we hereby request that the Legislative Assembly of Nova Scotia rectify this situation to provide the citizens of rural Kings County with the same access to high-speed internet as is available in more urban areas of Nova Scotia by the end of the 2014 calendar year. Mr. Speaker, I've affixed my name to this. There's 24 signatures on this petition.
The petition is tabled. We'll move on to presenting reports of committees. We'll move on to tabling reports, regulations, and other papers. We'll move on to statements by ministers. We'll move on to government notices of motion. We'll move on to introduction of bills. The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg leave to introduce an act to repeal certain statutes pertaining to forestry agreements.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Repeal Certain Statutes Pertaining to Forestry Agreements.
Bill number 32, entitled An Act to Repeal Certain Statutes Pertaining to Forestry Agreements.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. We'll move on to notices of motion. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled Fair Registration Practices Act, amended.
The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 38 of the Acts of 2008, the Fair Registration Practices Act.
Bill number 33, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 38 of the Acts of 2008, the Fair Registration Practices Act.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. The Honourable Minister of Justice.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg leave to introduce amendments to the Notaries and Commissioners Act.
The Honourable Minister of Justice begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 312 of the Revised Statutes 1989 of the Notaries and Commissioners Act.
Bill number 34, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 312 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Notaries and Commissioners Act.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. We'll now move on to notices of motion. pass that. The Honourable Government House Leader of the Official Opposition.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice on a future day I should move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the Argyle Minor Soccer Club has 323 youth registered to play last summer, and whereas the Argyle Minor Soccer Club has offered a summer of fun and competition for so many youth, including a jamboree for soccer skills and to end the season tournament. And whereas registration is currently underway for the 2014 soccer season, with the deadline being April 30th, therefore be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly extend our thanks to the hardworking executive of the Argyle Minor Hockey Club, President Tracy Surrett, Vice President Tracy Muse, Secretary Treasurer Nicole Albright, and Directors Natalie Surrett d'Entremont and Thomas Robichaud as they prepare for the upcoming season. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There's been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. I just want to remind everybody before we continue, it's kind of hard to hear in here, so let's keep the chatter down if we can. The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Nova Scotian nurses work hard every day to better the lives of their patients, and whereas nurses play a vital role in our publicly funded health system, providing passionate and professional care to their patients, and whereas nurses deserve to be treated fairly and equitably at every aspect of their work, including their safety and the safety of their patients, therefore be it resolved that the members of the House of Assembly support all nurses in every aspect of their workplaces and support their dedication, diligence, and professional commitment to Nova Scotians on a daily basis. And Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary minded? Nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Dartmouth South.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I stand today, sir, on behalf of yourself, the Honourable Kevin S. Murphy, MLA for Eastern Shore. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Cyril Young, born and raised in Muscadabit Harbour, is a longtime businessman and pillar of his community. Whereas Cyril worked in the family business in which he traveled the coastline in a freighter, selling various supplies to the residents of the shore. Cyril has seen many changes and development in his community over the years, including being present when electricity first made its way to the Eastern Shore. And whereas Cyril has continued to help his community as a chartered member of Muscadabit Harbour and District Lions Club and embodies the Lions' motto of "We Serve," therefore be it resolved that members of this House of Assembly join me in thanking Cyril Young for his continued service to the people of the Eastern Shore. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Pictou Centre.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Brian Campbell has served a remarkable 40 years with the Stellarton Fire Department, and whereas over his 40 years as a volunteer firefighter, Brian's record of being first at the station and his pager goal still ranks among the best of his fellow fire workers, and whereas Bruce is a solid volunteer firefighter who also assists with community fundraising efforts like pancake breakfasts, helping with the Christmas Eve parade, and instructing at the local fire school. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly commend Stellarton firefighter Brian Campbell for his legendary service with the Stellarton Fire Department and wish him many more years of success in the volunteer fire service. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There's been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Sydney, Whitney Pier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Chester Borden was the first African Nova Scotian student support worker hired by the Cape Breton Victoria Regional School Board, and whereas Chester Borden is presently the executive director of the Whitney Pier Youth Club, and whereas on March 21, 2014, Chester Borden was presented with the Carl Campy Crawford Award in recognition of his leadership and commitment to justice, fairness, volunteerism, sportsmanship, and equality to his community. Therefore, be it resolved that the Nova Scotia Legislature congratulate Chester Borden on his outstanding achievement and for his dedication and service to his community. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver and notice passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Halifax Atlantic.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day, I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the Active Kids program is in its second season and provides a free outdoor play program one day a week to elementary school students around the Halifax Atlantic Loop, and whereas the program is run by youth leaders who are responsible for the program planning and implementation with the help of parent volunteers to coordinate the program, and whereas this youth-run program provides outdoor activities and fosters team-building and cooperative play. Therefore, be it resolved that members of the House of Assembly commend the youth leaders of the Active Kids program for their dedication to making a difference in their community and helping to make physical activity a part of our children's lives in a fun and creative way. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Colchester, Musquodoboit Valley.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day, I will move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas David Bartlett of Hilden has been writing music since 1956, and whereas in 2013, Bartlett was a nominee for Music Nova Scotia's Inspirational Recording of the Year, and whereas Dave's song, The Way We Are, written in 1987 and recorded by Ben Everson, has been nominated for Gospel Recording of the Year at the 2014 East Coast Music Awards, scheduled to be held in Prince Edward Island, April the 2nd to the 6th. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of the House of Assembly congratulate Dave Bartlett for his rich musical talents and wish him the very best at the 2014 East Coast Music Awards. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice, passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Halifax hosted the first Atlantic Canada We Day on November 27, 2013, an inspirational event promoting global citizenship for youth, and whereas through acts of service, Lower Sackville's Brody Nichols, one of 40 students from Sackville High School, joined more than 8,000 students who earned admission to the Atlantic Canada's first We Day held in Halifax on November 27, 2013. And whereas during the We Day celebrations, Brody was the winner of a 10-day volunteer trip to Ecuador in July of 2014 to continue his growth in contributing to global community. Therefore, be it resolved that the House of Assembly commend Lower Sackville's Brody Nichols on his contribution to his community through We Day activities and wish him well as he travels to Ecuador in July 2014 to make a difference in our global community and wish him future success. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Lunenburg.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the World Rum Awards and the World Brandy Awards, part of the World Drink Awards, have been running since 2007 and attracts hundreds of entrants from 24 countries from around the globe, and whereas Pierre Gouvernement and Lynn McKay, owners of Ironworks Distillery in Lunenburg, have thrived since opening its doors in 2010. And whereas the company was awarded 5 gold medals in competition for the world's best dark rum, world's best brandy, world's best apple brandy, world's best fruit brandy, and world's best brandy design. Therefore, let it be resolved that all members of this House of Assembly congratulate Pierre and Lynn, owners of Ironworks Distillery, for their hard work and tremendous achievements at the World Brandy and Rum Awards. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Pictou East.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Nova Scotians are struggling to make ends meet, with many opting to leave Nova Scotia for job opportunities elsewhere, and whereas the provincial debt has ballooned to over $15 billion and the debt service and costs are currently the third most expensive line item in the budget, and whereas the Liberal government has signaled that it has chosen to continue this immoral act of passing debt along to our children and our children's children, therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly remind the Liberal government that Nova Scotians expect them to act and to make difficult decisions regarding the balance of the budget, creating jobs, and getting the province's economy back on track. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? I hear several noes. The motion is tabled. The Honourable Member for Chester St. Margaret's.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas on January 15, 2013, Golda Hallbolt celebrated her 100th birthday, and whereas Golda was born in Blandford, Nova Scotia, but has spent most of her life in Chester, where she is a well-known and much-loved member of the community, and whereas throughout her life, Golda has been an active member of the Chester community, working at various jobs such as a clerk at Henniker's store and at the English Sports Shop, as well as volunteering for St. Stephen's Anglican Church. Therefore, be it resolved that the Nova Scotia Legislature congratulates Golda Hallbolt and her family on her 100th birthday and wishes her health and happiness in years to come. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Cole Harbour, Eastern Passage.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Dorothy White has been an avid volunteer within the communities of Eastern Passage and Cow Bay, and whereas she has been the editor of the local newspaper, The Beacon, for 10 years, along with being a member of the Board of Directors and treasurer of the Eastern Passage Cow Bay Summer Carnival for several years, and is also on the Board of Directors and is the treasurer for Fisherman's Cove Committee. Whereas her hard work and dedication to these committee groups greatly enhanced the overall success of each one. Therefore, let it be resolved that the members of the House of Assembly join me in thanking Dorothy White for her outstanding efforts and commitment to our communities and wish her all the best in her future endeavors. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate. Thank you.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye. Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Kings North.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas 8 months a year, the Good Neighbour Club of Centerville serves a big breakfast of eggs, bacon, sausages, homemade hash browns, homemade beans, coffee, tea, juice, and toast. And whereas the 40 volunteers serve an average of 260 people at each event as a fundraiser, and whereas the Good Neighbor Club celebrated the 8th anniversary of this fundraising effort on February 19th, therefore be it resolved that all members of this House Assembly congratulate the Good Neighbor Club of Centerville on the 8th anniversary of its big breakfast fundraiser and thank members for making their community a good place to live and grow. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and pass without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Truro, Bible Hill, Millbrook, Salmon River.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the Atlantic Superstore in Truro hosted the President's Choice Children's Charity Program with a focus on the Brighter Breakfast Program, and whereas all money raised returns to the local community to help with breakfast programs in schools and families with children with special needs, and whereas to date proceeds have provided essentials such as a seeing eye dog, a backyard safety fence for an autistic child, 3 wheelchairs, and a bathtub lift, therefore be it resolved that the Nova Scotia Legislature congratulates the Atlantic Superstore's President's Choice Children's Charity Program and wishes it continued success in the future. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Timberley Prospect.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Cassidy Magan of Shad Bay, Nova Scotia, created the idea of Purple Day in 2008, motivated by her own struggles with epilepsy. Cassidy's goal was to get people talking about epilepsy in an effort to dispel myths and inform those with seizures that they are not alone. And whereas Cassidy Magan worked with MP Jeff Regan to pass Bill C-278, an act respecting a day to increase public awareness about epilepsy, which was passed unanimously by Parliament in 2012, the bill establishes March 26th as Purple Day. And whereas last year Cassidy Magan was among several young people across the Atlantic provinces of Canada who were honoured for their activities within the Canadian Red Cross. Cassidy Magan, at the age of 14, is one of the youngest recipients ever of the Canadian Red Cross Young Humanitarian Award. Therefore, be it resolved that on behalf of Nova Scotia Provincial Government and its constituencies, we send sincere congratulations on this remarkable achievement to Cassidy Magan and her family.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye. Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Pictou West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Mr. Luke Dimitri of Calgary, formerly of New Glasgow, participated at the 2014 Winter Olympics in Sochi, Russia, and whereas Luke was part of Canada 2, a four-man bobsled team for their final trip down the course, and whereas the Canadian 2 bobsled team was in last place following a mishap, but with the help of Luke, finished the final run in 10th place out of 30 teams at a time of 55.72 seconds. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly congratulate Mr. Luke Dimitri on his Olympic experience and wish him well as he continues to train for the 2018 Winter Games in South Korea. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Clare Digby.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Gilbert and Sigmar Dole of Gilbert's Cove have won the Nova Scotia Farm Environmental Stewardship Award, and whereas the Doles operate the Wild Rose Farm, a certified organic mixed vegetable, flower, herb, and livestock farm, and whereas the greenhouses on this farm are heated by sunlight, therefore be it resolved that all members of the House of Assembly join me in congratulating Gilbert and Sigmar Dole on being awarded the Nova Scotia Farm Environmental Stewardship Award. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Inverness.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Hugh Allen Buddy McMaster was awarded the Folk Alliance Lifetime Achievement Award for monumental contributions as a folk music performer in North America. And whereas Buddy joins 40 others awarded since 1995, including Pete Seeger, Bob Dylan, Joan Baez, Harry Belafonte, Robert Johnson, and the Carter family. And whereas he was chosen by a committee of 120 musicians, scholars, and presenters from the United States and Canada. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly congratulate my father, Buddy McMaster, for the gift of music he has so generously shared over the years. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Fairview, Clayton Park.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the students and staff of Fairview Junior High have successfully hosted a multicultural day on Thursday, January 30th, 2014, and whereas the event was designed to celebrate the school's diversity and multiculturalism and to showcase the students' many talents through unique performances and exhibits, and whereas the event promoted community inclusion and respect for all members of the community, therefore be it resolved that the members of this House of Assembly congratulate Fairview Junior High School for their efforts to increase community support for their members through this Multicultural Day's activities. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Hants West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day, I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas nurses are a crucial part of our health care system, and whereas the high quality of care they provide is what Nova Scotians deserve and have come to expect of our health care system, and whereas the potential for patient care to be put at risk as hospitals ramp down services due to labour dispute now exist, therefore be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly urge the Premier to take action to protect vulnerable Nova Scotians and ensure their health services are there when they need them. And Mr. Speaker, I would request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? I hear several no's. The motion is tabled. The Honourable Member for Sydney, Whitney Pier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hereby give notice on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Nancy Kinsman has worked 35 years for the Government of Nova Scotia. Whereas Nancy has worked with 13 speakers of the House of Assembly in this legislature. Whereas Nancy's last day working for the Nova Scotia Government and the House of Assembly will be Friday, March the 28th, 2014. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of the House of Assembly congratulate Nancy Kinsman for her dedication and years of service to all members of the legislature, past and present. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There's been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Sackville Beaverbank.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a day, a future day,
I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the Curves Bootylicious Girls is a major fundraising team for the Cancer Relay for Life in Sackville, Nova Scotia, Team Captain Brenda Callback is proud to lead a team that has raised a total of $33,489 since forming in 2009. Brenda decided to relay as a way of remembering and honoring loved ones and friends, as well as a way to make a difference for those who are and will be fighting cancer. Whereas the Curves Bootylicious Girls begin fundraising immediately following relay and work throughout the year to meet the fundraising target they set for themselves. Fundraising takes many forms: flea markets, bingo nights, a bowling night, and selling tickets on many items, including breakfasts, potlucks, and 50-50 tickets. All items are donated and in the past have included art pieces and craft. Whereas Brenda is enthusiastically planning for the 2014 relay in June to share memories and know that they are making a difference. Therefore, be it resolved that the member of this House of Assembly recognize Brenda Callback, captain of the Team Curves Bootylicious Girls, for her dedication to relaying and her determination to make a difference in the fight against cancer. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye. Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Colchester, Musquodoboit Valley.
Mr. Speaker, I give notice that on a future day I will move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas to many people in many cultures, music is an important part of their way of life, and whereas the community of Brookfield is enriched with musical talent consisting of so many individuals from church choirs to award-winning school bands, and whereas the Putman family, the Pioneers, and the Kitchen Trio are all well-known Brookfield musicians performing across Nova Scotia, therefore be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly acknowledge the tremendous gift of music blessed upon such a wide variety of Brookfield musical artists, and wish them nothing but continued success. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice, passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Cumberland North.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Larry Ogden of Tignish, Cumberland County, Nova Scotia, has received the 2014 Provincial Volunteer Award, and whereas Larry Ogden is being honoured for the tremendous contributions he has made to his community and to the province, and whereas Larry Ogden donates his time to help others by supporting the causes in which he believes in various ways, and especially through the Pick and Grin family. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of this House of Assembly commend Larry Ogden on being the honored recipient of the 2014 Provincial Volunteer Award. Mr. Speaker, I hereby request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Kings North.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the Valley Regional Health Foundation gathers community support for major financial purchases of medical equipment to meet the province's requirement that the community provide 25% of the required funding. And whereas through the generosity of thousands of donors, the foundation has provided over $16 million to improve health care for the residents of Kings and Annapolis County. And whereas last December the foundation's annual Festival of Lights raised $182,000, therefore be resolved that all members of this House of Assembly congratulate the Valley Regional Health Foundation on another successful fundraiser and its mission of supporting health care in the Annapolis Valley. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and patch of debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Minister of Service, Nova Scotia, Municipal Relations.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the Bridgewater Junior High Boys Hockey Team competed in the regional finals on March 4, 2014, and whereas the Bridgewater Junior High Hockey Team defeated North Kings Education Center with a final score of 6-5, ending the season undefeated in league play, and whereas the Bridgewater Junior High Hockey Team won their first regional banner in a junior high hockey tournament, therefore, be it resolved that all members of the House of Assembly congratulate the Bridgewater Junior Boys Hockey Team for their successful season and for winning their first regional banner. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There's been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Inverness.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas the Ivany Report calls for a bold new direction for the province to combat the demographic and economic challenges faced by our province, and whereas Nova Scotia will lose close to 17% of its working population by 2038, and whereas the Ivany Report states that the responsibility for leadership and initiative rests with the private sector and with government, therefore be it resolved that all members of this House of Assembly urge the new Liberal government to govern by making the changes needed to turn our province around. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Cole Harbour, Portland Valley, and the Minister of Communities, Cultures and Heritage.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Ben Russell of Cole Harbour is a member of the Canadian National Canoe and Kayak Team, 2007 Pan Am Games bronze medalist, 2013 International Canoe Federation World Championship medalists, finalists in 2009, 10, and 11. And whereas Ben has been a community ambassador, motivational speaker, public affairs, and coach of the Lake Bonook Canoe Club, and whereas Ben has been selected as part of the RBC Olympian at RBC Athlete at the Canoe and Kayak Canada, and now has his sights set firmly on the 2016 Rio de Janeiro Olympic Games, where he hopes to win a gold medal in the C2-1000 event. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of the House of the Assembly congratulate Ben Russell on his new inclusion to the RBC Olympian program, and wish him continued success in the future. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid on an introduction.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to draw members' attention to the East Gallery, where we have a former member of the House, Sid Press, from the riding, used to be the MLA for riding the Eastern Shore. Just would like all members to give him a warm welcome.
Minister of the Environment.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Bryden Tate of Heatherton, Anakinish County, is the team captain of the St. Francis Xavier Axeman track and field team, and whereas he helped lead the team to their first ever Atlantic University Sports Track and Field Championship, where he was a double gold medalist, winning both the 1,000 and 1,500 meter races, and whereas he was named AUS Male Athlete of the Year, as well as one of Male Track Athlete of the Year, as well as one of the Subway AUS Athletes of the Week for the period ending February 23, 2014, Therefore, be it resolved, the members of this House Assembly congratulate Bryden on receiving these honors and for leading his team to victory. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. The motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Halifax, Chibucto.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby notice that on a future day I shall move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Aerobics First is a local business who is dedicated and has high amounts of community spirit, and whereas during the annual trip, the running event, trade show in Austin, Texas, held December 3rd to 6th, 2013, the company was presented with the prestigious Umbuntu Award. And whereas Umbuntu is an African concept that means welcoming, hospitable, warm, generous, and willing to share, in recent years, the store has formed partnerships with Nova Scotia Lung Association and Learn to Run for Smokers, co-founded the Youth Running Series, and partnered up with the Start to Finish, an after-school program that teaches strength and confidence through running. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of the House of Assembly congratulate Aerobics First for all of their hard work and dedication to give back to the community, strengthen local bonds, and create positive change. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Member for Guysborough Eastern Shore Tracadie.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I shall move adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Keegan Luddington of Torbay is a 13-year-old who was diagnosed with undetermined colitis in grade 3 and has been living with the diagnosis since then, and whereas his application has been selected by the Make-A-Wish Foundation for a wish this year, Keegan and his family have almost 1 year to plan for their once-in-a-lifetime trip, a Disney cruise with visits to interesting countries, Jamaica, Mexico, and other Caribbean locales. And whereas Keegan is looking forward to the trip, and this will help him get through the two surgeries he has scheduled in July, Keegan's message to other kids dealing with difficult medical conditions is hope for the best and keep on trucking. Therefore, be it resolved that all members of the House of Assembly recognize Keegan for his upbeat outlook on life and be ever so mindful of the importance of the Make-A-Wish Foundation as they create miracles one wish at a time. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
It is agreed. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I should move adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Ryan McIsaac launched his business, The Battered Fish, out of a food truck in Bedford in 2009, and whereas The Battered Fish, which offers fast, casual dining with fresh cooked seafoods and salads, has since expanded into 4 new locations in the Halifax region and plans continued expansion across Canada and the United States. And whereas The Battered Fish, with top-notch food and service standards, was the gold medal winner of the 2014 Halifax Business Awards presented in January by the Halifax Chamber of Commerce. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of this House of Assembly congratulate Ryan McIsaac on his award and his plan to share a little piece of Nova Scotia with the world. Mr. Speaker, I ask for waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is aye. Carried. The Honourable Member for Dartmouth South.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice that on a future day I will move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Renee Lavallee of Dartmouth is a chef, entrepreneur, and popular online food blogger. And whereas Renee recently fulfilled her dream of creating a community gathering place of excellent seasonal food and learning by building on her downtown Dartmouth network and exploring her passion for cooking. And whereas Renee opened the Canteen, a sandwich shop with an exciting and delicious local seasonal menu at 66 Ochterlony Street in Dartmouth on Monday, March 24th of this year.
Therefore, be it resolved that members of this House of Assembly join me in offering sincere congratulations to Renee Lavallee and her team on the opening of the canteen, and wish your new business in downtown Dartmouth many years of success and prosperity. Mr. Speaker, I request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There's been a request for waiver. Is it agreed? It is agreed. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye. Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried. We'll now move on to orders of the day. And we'll now move on to oral questions put to members, put by members to ministers. The time is now 2:53 on the clock, and we will finish at 3:53. The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Today, Capitol Health has started ramping down their services to Nova Scotians in anticipation of a strike. Real Nova Scotians are now facing actual service cancellations and postponed important medical procedures. In other words, Mr. Speaker, patient care is now already at risk, despite what the Premier says. My question to the Premier, will he tell the House today how he plans to protect patient care starting now?
The Honourable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, as all members of this House would know, and indeed all Nova Scotians know, there are challenges between the employer, which is Capitol Health, and NSGEU when it comes to providing nursing services in the Capital Region. As they would also know that the process is unfolding through the collective bargaining process. We are, like all Nova Scotians watching it, encouraging both sides to get back to the table to ensure that Nova Scotians have the services that they need and want when they want them.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his first supplementary.
Thank you.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his first supplementary. That's what you guys get for bending the mic, see? Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. What Nova Scotians know is that their Premier told them that he would protect their health care. But today, real notices are going out about cancelled health care procedures, tests, and otherwise, Mr. Speaker. They are not protected today, Mr. Speaker, because of the anticipation of a strike. Premier says that he's disappointed in the actions on both sides and the amount of rhetoric that is being displayed in the media as the negotiations go on. Yet he himself has jumped in with his own overheated rhetoric, Mr. Speaker, making matters worse. He is the one that threatened nurses by questioning their licenses and telling them that they were in violation of their code of ethics. Mr. Speaker, I will table those quotes for the benefit of the House. I will ask the Premier, how does questioning the integrity of nurses help protect patient care?
The Honourable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Leader of the Opposition couldn't be more wrong, quite frankly. We've continued to actually tell Nova Scotians the valuable contribution that nurses make in the healthcare system in this province, Mr. Speaker. They do operate under code of ethics, Mr. Speaker, and the Leader of the Opposition would know that it's the College of Registered Nurses that would be the person and the body that those RNs and nurses would report to, Mr. Speaker. What we have clearly said is that in these very difficult times around bargaining, we would like both sides to get back to the table to ensure that we find an agreement that both sides can live with and that Nova Scotians actually receive the health care services when they want them, at the time they want them, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, actually it's the Premier that is mistaken. What Nova Scotians want is a Premier that says the same thing, and that saying something is not the same as doing something. They are looking for action now that real medical tests and procedures are being cancelled or postponed. And what I mean by that, Mr. Speaker, is that in opposition, the Premier actually encouraged the government of Nova Scotia to get involved in a labour dispute at Capitol Health between the health authority and their workers. And he said at that time, just a year ago, and I quote, they, meaning the government, are the employer. So it's important for them to make sure that they solve these disputes as quickly as possible without a labour interruption. And I'll table that for the benefit of the Premier, Mr. Speaker. 1 week ago, he said exactly the opposite, that he himself is actually not the employer, even though Nova Scotians know who ultimately is paying the bills and pulling the strings. So you know what, Mr. Speaker? It's time for straight answers. Will the Premier get to the point today when real procedures are being cancelled and tell Nova Scotians the plan to protect their patient care?
The Honourable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, as you know, anytime there is this kind of negotiation that's moving very close to what potentially could be a labour disruption, there are lots of anxieties going not only, Mr. Speaker, through those that are involved in it from a working point of view, but obviously those Nova Scotians who are receiving and looking to receive that services. That's why we've continued to encourage both sides to get back to the table, the employer, which is Capital Health, and the NSGEU, which is the union representing the nurses in the Capital Health. And, Mr. Speaker, I'll go one step further. Nova Scotians know that when, if there's one leader in this House who goes back on his word, it's not the Premier, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is also through you to the Premier. Mr. Speaker, 2,300 registered nurses throughout the Capital District Health Authority will be in a legal strike position on April the 3rd. At the heart of this dispute, Mr. Speaker, is that nurses are regularly working shorthanded. And I'm sure all members of this House are hearing from nurses who are very concerned about patient safety, as well as their own health and safety, Mr. Speaker. So my question through you to the Premier is this. Will the Premier tell us what he is doing to reassure nurses that they are respected and they are heard?
The Honourable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, our government continues to ensure that Nova Scotians have access to health care where and when they need it, Mr. Speaker. It is extremely important that we recognize that the valuable contribution that all health care providers provide to the people of this province. I want to remind all members of this House that it is Capital Health, who was the employer in this dispute, Mr. Speaker, who is now dealing with the NSGEU, Mr. Speaker. And through a number of times, through collective bargaining agreements across this province, unions and their employers have been able to work out the ratio when it comes to ensuring that the proper levels of staffing are happening in all various aspects of delivering health care to this province.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, Mr. Speaker, since contract talks have broken off, the Premier has done little more than add fuel on the fire by stating that nurses should face discipline before their licensing body if they take job action. And Mr. Speaker, he made these statements before the provincially appointed mediator had even brought the parties together. So Mr. Speaker, I want to have the Premier explain how exactly such comments could be a constructive intervention into this dispute, especially at such a critical point in the negotiating process.
The Honourable Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it is our sincere hope that both the employer and the union will go back to the table. We've encouraged them at every turn to go back to the table so that we can try to find a negotiated settlement that would allow both sides to continue to provide the services to Nova Scotians that they require and that they want, Mr. Speaker, and it is our sincere hope that that happens. I want to remind the members of this House, Mr. Speaker, this contract has been outstanding, Mr. Speaker, for almost 2 years now. We've been in power for 6 months, Mr. Speaker. We are now, while this is a difficult challenge for all Nova Scotians, we are watching, allowing the collective bargaining process to happen, Mr. Speaker, but we, at the end of the day, Mr. Speaker, will make sure that Nova Scotians are protected when it comes to delivery of health care services.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party on her final supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, Mr. Speaker, the Premier may only have been the Premier for 6 months, but he sat in this House for many, many years and said many, many things about the collective bargaining process. And let me remind him that he told Nova Scotians when he sat on this side of the House that he believed in collective bargaining, yet we saw just 28 days ago a reversal on that position with the home support workers, Mr. Speaker. So, Mr. Speaker, I want to ask the Premier, why does he no longer believe in the collective bargaining process?
The Honourable Premier.
Speaker, thank you. I thank the honourable member for the question, Mr. Speaker. I want to remind all members of this House that 28 days ago we brought in essential service legislation that actually protected the right to strike for health care workers, Mr. Speaker. All we asked for, Mr. Speaker, what we asked for was that before job action took place, that we ensured that the essential services of health care delivers in this province. But I want to remind the leader of the New Democratic Party that there has been a time in our history when the right to strike was taken away from health care workers. It was from paramedics not too long ago, Mr. Speaker, under the New Democratic government of Nova Scotia. So the only party in this House who's taken away the right to strike in recent history has been the New Democratic Party.
Leader of the official opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to return to the theme of leaders that are consistent in what they say to the people of Nova Scotia. When he was running for office, the Premier told the Cape Breton Post that he wouldn't legislate against work stoppages in the health care system. And I'll quote directly. The Premier says, "The Liberals have no plans to legislate against work stoppages in the health system," the Premier says. Mr. Speaker, hospital workers took him at his word on that. But of course, that was when he was trying to get their votes, Mr. Speaker. Now we're all waiting to see what the plan is of the government to protect patient care. So my simple question to the Premier, who said one thing 6 short months ago and is going to do the opposite now, which statement should Nova Scotians rely on today? What the Premier said when he was running or the ones now?
The Honourable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, we're going to allow the collective bargaining process to continue, Mr. Speaker. It's our hope that the employer and the union will come to the table to ensure that they find an agreement, that both sides are satisfied, that will ensure that we provide the services to Nova Scotians. And in no time, Mr. Speaker, have I or our government in any way removed the right to strike away from health care workers in this province at any time, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, we are soon going to have a strike on our hands at Capitol Health with the vital services that nurses provide. Surgeries and labs and clinics are going to be scaled back or cancelled or closed. The Premier has inflamed the situation by questioning the ethics of nurses, threatening to refer them to their own college of nurses. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotians do not want to see the end of their health care service, or even a gigantic reduction in health care services. Can the Premier assure Nova Scotians today that their health care will not be lowered, reduced, or otherwise stopped due to a contract dispute?
The Honourable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, unlike the leader of the Conservative Party, I believe in the collective bargaining process, Mr. Speaker. We are allowing the collective bargaining process to happen. Mr. Speaker, there are some challenges, but I want to assure all members of this House, Mr. Speaker, that this government believes in providing Nova Scotia with the quality health care, and that will be identified when our budget is delivered, Mr. Speaker, in a week.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his final supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I guess the answer to that question is no, he can't assure them that their health care services won't be lowered or reduced or otherwise impacted over the next few weeks. And I remind the Premier that everything he says today is recorded in this House, and it'll be here for the benefit of all Nova Scotians next week to see, compared to what he is saying now, just like it was recorded 6 months ago in the election campaign. Mr. Speaker, every Nova Scotian would agree that nurses are vital to our health care system. The care they provide is second to none. Nurses insist that their staffing levels in our wards and hospitals is inadequate and that they are overworked and stressed out. Premier, of course, is trying to silence them on this issue by threatening to take them to their own college of nurses. My question to the Premier, the person responsible ultimately for the health care system, has he taken any steps to assure himself that our hospitals are, in fact, adequately staffed?
The Honourable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, we continue, Mr. Speaker, to monitor the situation to ensure, Mr. Speaker, that health care will be provided to Nova Scotians. I want to remind the Leader of the Opposition that we are not the employer, Mr. Speaker. It is Capital Health. We cannot refer any nurses, Mr. Speaker, to anything. So he continues to try to find some way to move away from the point that he is against the collective bargaining process, Mr. Speaker. Unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, we believe in the collective bargaining process. We are allowing it to unfold, and we will make sure that Nova Scotians' health care is protected, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, quite frankly, I think that Nova Scotians know full well where our party stands on protecting their health care and contract disputes. We know what the Premier is against. Honestly, we're trying to figure out what the Premier is for and what he intends to do, and we're not getting any straight answers on that today, Mr. Speaker. Well, already important procedures are starting to be cancelled or postponed. But it is the role of the government to lead, and primarily to protect the health care that Nova Scotians rely on every day, Mr. Speaker. Nurses are saying that they are overworked, that they are stressed out, that there is too much overtime, that there are real wards that are understaffed. They may be right. We have to find that out, Mr. Speaker, and ultimately it's the elected government that looks after our health care system. So I will ask the Premier quite simply, what action has the Premier taken to ensure there really are appropriate levels of nursing staff in our hospitals?
Honourable Premier.
Speaker, Mr. Speaker, I want to remind the Leader of the Opposition, the government is not at the bargaining table, Mr. Speaker. That is the employer and the union, Mr. Speaker. But I also want to remind this House that the Minister of Health, in the first 5 months of being the Minister of Health, has been travelling the province, working with district health authorities across this province to ensure that we streamline administration and health care system, ensure that we make sure they have the appropriate levels of staffing in every hospital across this region, to ensure that every community gets access to health care when and where they need it at the appropriate levels, and quite frankly, Mr. Speaker, that employees who work for district health authorities and work in the health care system feel appreciated.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I know the nurses don't feel appreciated by a Premier that actually calls their ethics into question when they raise questions about whether our hospital wards are properly staffed or not. And he can point the fingers as many other places as he wants. It's his government that needs to make sure that our hospitals are properly staffed, not by threatening people who want to bargain collectively, but by doing the job of running the province, including our health care system. So I will ask the Premier, when will he take steps to make sure our hospitals are properly staffed?
The Honourable Premier.
Speaker, I want to assure through you to the Leader of the Opposition and all Nova Scotians, October 22nd last year, this government started ensuring that not only were health care properly staffed, but, Mr. Speaker, that the money was being spent on frontline health care, not administration.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his final supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we're going to see over the next few days how good a job the government does at making sure those health care services are there all of the time and for everybody that needs them. Because today, Capital Health is winding down real health care services to real Nova Scotians. That means everyday people are going without the health care services that they need, and we're here in this House, and we're ready to pass something that helps them know, without worry, that they'll get the care they need. But he doesn't answer the questions about what the plan is. We'll wait all through the weekend and into next week while more and more surgeries and other procedures are cancelled, Mr. Speaker. So I will ask the Premier, why is even a ramp down in our health service acceptable to him?
The Honourable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, it was indeed the hope of all Nova Scotians, Mr. Speaker, that the collective bargaining process would have worked by now and allowed that that we would have had a settlement that both sides would be happy with to allow the continue. But Mr. Speaker, when the collective bargaining process you end up reaching the point where both union and employer find it difficult at times. They move away from conversation. It's our hope that they get back to the table so that they can make sure, Mr. Speaker, that the strike will be averted and that Nova Scotians will continue to receive the health care services that they want.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it's just been 5 months since this party formed the government in Nova Scotia is already facing its second health care strike. Back in 2007, when the Premier sat on the opposition benches, he wrote an opinion piece in which he said, and I quote, "The collective bargaining process is working in Nova Scotia. Our health care workers want to be on the job, not the picket line." Mr. Speaker, I'll table a copy of that opinion piece. My question for the Premier, Mr. Speaker, is this. Why under his government are health care workers suddenly having to go on the picket line?
The Honourable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I still believe, Mr. Speaker, that the collective bargaining process is the right way to solve the issues that are being faced between the union and their employer in the health care sector, Mr. Speaker. We're allowing that process to unfold, Mr. Speaker, and the reason, quite frankly, that we've had two challenges come up is because the previous government ignored them, Mr. Speaker, for almost 2 years.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party on her first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'd like the member to show me any of the disputes that the former government got into with the nurses of this province. That government respected the nurses in Nova Scotia, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, in 2007...
Order, please. The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party has the floor.
I think I hit a nerve over there, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, in 2007, the Premier said, and I quote, in the same opinion piece, "Our health care system has not been plagued with strikes or work stoppages. In the last 25 years, there have been 3 hospital strikes in Nova Scotia. Today, that's 32 years, and there have been 3. So my question for the Premier, is a plague of chaos in the health care system what we can expect under your government?
The Honourable Premier.
No, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, when I wrote that opinion piece in 2007, I had no idea that Nova Scotians would have a government that would neglect health care bargaining for 4 years like happened under the previous government. Mr. Speaker, I want to assure the member and all Nova Scotians, Mr. Speaker, that this government is going to continue to work to make sure that all those who provide services to Nova Scotians recognize they're appreciated and recognize that there is a fiscal challenge that the province is in and that we will operate and deliver those services inside of that envelope.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party on her final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I have one final quote from the Premier's 2007 opinion piece. And I'd like to quote this. He said, "Many of the province's healthcare workers are on the front line every day. They know what happens if they are not there to provide care to Nova Scotians when they need it. They know better than anyone else how important their jobs are and how much people rely on their care every day." So my final question to the Premier, Mr. Speaker, if he believes nurses know best what they need to do their job, why is he publicly dismissing their concerns about the impact of staff shortages on public safety?
The Honourable Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the Honourable Member for the question. There is absolutely no question, Mr. Speaker, that nurses and all health care providers provide an invaluable service to Nova Scotians. It is our job as government to ensure that that service will be there, but we need to allow the collective bargaining process to happen as an employer. Mr. Speaker, is working with the union, Mr. Speaker. And I want to assure all members of this House that we have heard from nurses, Mr. Speaker, who want to continue to work. They want to ensure that the service is there for Nova Scotians. And we hope, Mr. Speaker, that their union and their employer can come together to ensure that all of those get an opportunity to continue to deliver the great quality of service they have been to Nova Scotians.
The Honourable Member for Pictou East.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question today is for the Minister of Finance. We learned this week that the Minister will table her budget on April 3rd. April 3rd is shaping up to be a terrible day for Nova Scotians. Sadly, we learned that this Liberal budget will not be balanced and that our debt will continue to increase. Well, in opposition, in 2008, the leader of the Liberal Party said, "Until we conquer our own debt, we will continue to be slaves to it, as well as our children and their children. And I agree with that statement, and I'm sure most members of this House do as well. So my question today for the Minister of Finance is, why has the Minister chosen to allow Nova Scotians to continue to be slaves to debt rather than take bold action to conquer it?
The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I do appreciate the question from the Honourable Member. Again, the member doesn't know yet what's in our budget for next week, but I have signaled there'll be a deficit, absolutely. And I think it's important for all members of the House to realize exactly how much our revenues have been hit, which I told the Chamber of Commerce this week, and how deeply we have to work hard to grow the economy. That's the best answer for us to get out of this situation. And in the meantime, we have critical services that have to be delivered.
The Honourable Member for Pictou East on his first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answer. And it's not an answer that's unfamiliar to Nova Scotians. Nova Scotians are looking to the government for answers as to how we can do that, how we can get a plan to increase our revenues, because every day in households across Nova Scotia, people are concerned about their own debt. People are losing sleep about the amount of their debt. So my question today is, if Nova Scotians are concerned about debt, why doesn't this government seem to be concerned about it?
Honourable Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And in answer to that, absolutely, I think all members of the House are concerned about the level of debt that we carry. In the last 4 years, the debt had risen by $1.5 billion, and that's certainly something that we would like to see slow down and stop and eventually be reversed. But that isn't something you can do in a time when there's not enough revenue to balance the books at this moment. So it's really a question of how we move forward, and with the help of all Nova Scotians. It isn't government's job alone to build the economy. We have to set the stage and work with the Nova Scotians. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Pictou East on his final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answer, and I agree. It is the job of government to create an environment where business has a chance to be successful. And Nova Scotians are making sacrifices every day. Every day they decide what they can afford and what they can't afford. Mr. Speaker, the problem with debt is you have to service it. And our debt costs are impeding the government's ability to make the lives of Nova Scotians better. Our debt service costs today are the third highest expenditure of the government. Nearly $900 million to service our debt. That's $900 million that will not go to services. $900 million that will not go to tax relief. $900 million that will not go to our health care services or education system. It will go towards our debt. And we need to start today finding an answer to bring this debt down. So my question for the Minister today is, why should Nova Scotians accept another year without leadership and a budget that will continue to enslave Nova Scotians to increasing debt and higher debt service costs?
The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Oh, I get up too fast. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I think the member opposite has done a good job explaining the scope of the debt. The impact that it has on our annual budget is significant. And the cost really is a burden for all Nova Scotians and all of us who seek services and know that the money is going elsewhere. But that is a debt that has grown over many, many years, Mr. Speaker. A great deal of it grew during the years of the Tory government in the 1980s. A huge increase. Mr. Speaker, it's grown over a long time, and it's not something that you can immediately turn around. So I think we have to look to the future to grow our economy, to seize a lot of the opportunities that we have in different sectors, and to really build up our business community, again, through creating the right environment, in order to get the money that we need to start working on this big issue. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton Centre.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Labour and Advanced Education. Mr. Speaker, previous to the election of this Liberal government, work stoppages and health care were about as commonplace as the Leafs making the playoffs, Mr. Speaker. But now, since the short 5 months since this crowd has been in power, we've seen that
strikes by home care workers, and now they're threatening, Mr. Speaker, to cause a strike with nurses in the Capital District Health Authority. So, Mr. Speaker, I want to ask the minister now that just a month ago they gave around $100,000 to a has-been Liberal cabinet minister from Ontario to tell the Minister of Finance how to run the taxes of the province of this of Nova Scotia. So I want to ask, are they contemplating the same, getting an outside Liberal hack to help them understand labour relations in Nova Scotia?
The Honourable Minister of Labour.
Mr. Speaker, I do believe hack is probably unparliamentary, so the member may wish to withdraw that particular remark for a start, but that's the Speaker's ruling. I would note, Mr. Speaker, that the person to whom he is referring is a respected woman parliamentarian, and I realize that the folks over there sometimes have difficulty with strong women, but I would note... Mr. Speaker, that in fact the member is in error. The last time the Leafs made the playoffs or won a championship, it would have been in 1967, and in fact they had a strike last year in the healthcare system. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton Centre on his supplementary.
Speaker. Thank you. You know, to be fair to the minister, I realize that more than often than not, what befalls your department is put there by the premier, Mr. Speaker, and they're kind of forced to do the premier's bidding. So my question to the Minister of Labour, has she advised the premier that the damage he has done to the health care workers in this province will not be easily undone? And will she stand up for the workers of this province and not for the Premier?
The Honourable Minister of Labour.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would note that when the union applied and asked for a mediator, I in fact appointed a mediator. I have been pretty clear here that we expect both sides to negotiate, and we are waiting for that process to play out. Mr. Speaker, but for the member to suggest that that people aren't doing their jobs or whatever, when they in fact had a strike in the healthcare system, is beyond the pale.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton Centre on his final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'd like to know what strike the Labour Minister is talking about. Imaginary. There was no strike, Mr. Speaker. Anyway, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to table an article here from the Chronicle Herald where the minister then in opposition, that she was, I believe, the education critic, said that we don't believe it and take it or leave it ultimatums. We're not collective bargaining. That's what she said back then, Mr. Speaker. But just a few weeks ago, the Premier told home care workers if they didn't take the deal that was on the table, there'd be something worse there. So I want to ask that minister, Mr. Speaker, is why is she doing the Premier's bidding? Why does she support the Premier and his attack on locals and in unions in healthcare that are predominantly made up of women? Why is she leading that charge against women in the workforce, Mr. Speaker?
The Honourable Minister of Labour.
Mr. Speaker, as I pointed out in another op-ed just recently, many of the people who are receiving home care are in fact women. The majority of elderly people in fact are women. So we were protecting those women who relied on that particular service. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Pictou West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question through you is for the Minister of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism. As we all know, the TRAVS report was released last week, and in opposition, the Liberals agreed that the Cabinet should not, and I repeat, should not be in control of the Cabinet-controlled Jobs Fund. The TRAVS report also says that the Jobs Fund should have independent oversight. Will the minister commit to removing cabinet control from this fund?
The Honourable Minister of Economic Development.
Mr. Speaker, we welcome the report from Dr. Travis in which he did recommend that there be an independent body that would oversee decisions being made by what's currently known as the Jobs Fund. I have indicated that the Jobs Fund will be no more and that you will be seeing changes made to that body and that will incorporate the changes made by the Travis report as well. But Mr. Speaker, actions speak louder than words. Since we have been elected, other than the Yarmouth Ferry deal, which had been negotiated by the previous administration, our government has not used the Nova Scotia Jobs Fund.
The Honourable Member for Pictou West on her first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for your informative answer. We all know that's decades that we've practiced corporate handouts, and we know that it clearly doesn't work. We don't need a second NSBI or another layer of bureaucracy, to hold up important economic investments. And I'm just wondering, when will we get on with the game changers that this province needs and you show real leadership in taking those bold changes?
The Honourable Minister of Economic Development.
Speaker, she'd understand. Obviously, Mr. Speaker, as soon as we did come into office, we initiated a number of changes, number of reviews. We asked Dr. Travis to review the tools being used in economic development. We as well undertook a review of venture capital to see whether that was being used as well as it should be used to the benefit of this province. So we just received a report a week ago. We are working through that right now. As indicated, changes are coming to the Jobs Fund, and we're certainly looking forward to implementing Dr. Travis's recommendations. In fact, a lot of that work is currently already underway, and a number of initiatives have already been implemented, and I'll certainly be announcing more in the days and weeks to come.
The Honourable Member for Pictou West on her final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Liberal Party ran an election based on a promise and a message that there would be no more public money for big companies. In opposition, the Premier said the following about the Cabinet-controlled fund. This is nothing more than a sham. Government should be embarrassed to stand up and suggest that this is rebranding, that this is about trying to be optimistic about the future. This is nothing more than keeping the old fund available to this Cabinet. If they really want to try something different, maybe they would have moved the investment arm out of the government to an arm's length, the business arm. My question is this a case of the Liberal Party saying one thing before the election and another after, or will the minister promise to move the investment arm out of government?
The Honourable Minister of Economic Development.
Mr. Speaker, sometimes it's a disadvantage to having been around this legislature a long time, but other times it becomes useful because I remember the 1999 election campaign. In fact, I believe the leader of the opposition may be able to assist a member because I believe he may have worked on the platform at that time for the John Hamm government, which promised that if elected, it would not use the Industrial Expansion Fund and there'd be no more handout to business. Now, that lasted about 6 months, Mr. Speaker, before Premier Hamm brought back the Industrial Expansion Fund. Now, I have to say, in his defense, he was an amateur at the use of that fund than the last government that used $800 million of taxpayers' money through that fund with little to no oversight. Mr. Speaker, as I said in my previous answer, actions speak louder than words. Other than the Yarmouth Ferry funding, which was negotiated by the previous government, our government has not used the Nova Scotia Jobs Fund, and the Nova Scotia Jobs Fund will exist no longer once the changes are implemented.
The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question today is through you to the Minister of Health. Every day in our province, nurses are providing care to Nova Scotians when they need it the most. It's a hard job, Mr. Speaker. It's a frustrating job, and at times it can be a thankless job. But you don't have to take my word for it, Mr. Speaker. In November, the Health Minister told the Chronicle Herald, and I quote, "Nobody should have to come to work and work in an environment where there's no chance of getting a break whatsoever from the demands of a job because they're one nurse short." But today, Mr. Speaker, while nurses at Capitol Health are saying they are regularly working shorthanded and are worried about patient safety. We have the Premier in the media stating that there are enough nurses. So I'd like to ask the Minister of Health, through you, Mr. Speaker, does he think nurses at Capital Health deserve to be given a break when they need it, or does he agree with the Premier that they are asking for too much?
The Honourable Minister of Health.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Honourable Member for the question. One of the basic realities and facts about the number of nurses in Nova Scotia is that, as a group, we are well above the national average. On a given floor, a given unit, we can have, in fact, a call-in very late, you know, before a shift, and there may be times, in fact, when staff is down a little bit. But overall, we don't hear of major complaints about lack of staffing to handle, especially at the QE2, the highest levels of tertiary care. Those patients are getting outstanding care from the nurses at the QE2.
The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid on his first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, but I'm hearing from nurses quite often over the last number of months, and what the Minister is describing is not what I'm hearing from those nurses. On February 6th of this year, the Minister wrote in the column of the Kings County Register, and I quote, "As Minister of Health, it's my job to improve the health of all citizens. To do this, we need a population that looks after its own health. One of those ways the public could look after its own health," the Minister said, "was by listening to nurses, prescribing daily exercise." So my question through you, Speaker, to the Minister of Health is simple. If he thinks it's crucial for our healthcare system, for Nova Scotians to listen to nurses, why is his government refusing to do the same?
The Honourable Minister of Health.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and through to the Honourable Member. You know, we first of all have the highest regard for nurses right across Nova Scotia. We listen to them. At the present time, there's a very challenging, very difficult labour dispute between their employer and the Nova Scotia Government Employees Union. And on a day-to-day basis, the work that our nurses do in our hospitals, in public health, in nursing homes, in all those areas, we will continue to listen to what they need in the profession. We know that we're fortunate to have three outstanding nursing training institutions in the province, and daily their work as a result of that great training goes into practice to provide high quality care for Nova Scotians right across the province.
The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid on his final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I don't think the Minister came close to answering my question, but that's okay. I think that's his role. I was there at one point in time, so I completely understand. In the same article from February 6th, Mr. Speaker, which I tabled, the Minister also quoted, also said, and I quote, "Imagine if healthcare works like banks," end quote, Mr. Speaker. So my question to the Minister, is he going to continue to running his department like a bank, placing dollars and cents ahead of patients' safety and nurses' collective bargaining right, or is he going to start doing his job, which he says is to improve the healthcare of all citizens of our province?
The Honourable Minister of Health.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I think the first months have gone well as I've gotten to know the system from one end of the province to the other. I think you'll see that our budget for health this year will speak volumes in terms of wanting to improve the system, reduce wait times, and make sure that our nurses and all employees in the healthcare system are adequately compensated, and that regard for their work, in fact, will be seen as we put on the table what I consider to be a responsible and a responsive call to making sure there are dollars for Nova Scotians to get the care they well deserve.
The Honourable Member for Clare Digby.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I have a question for Minister Colwell, Minister of Fisheries and Aquaculture. This question's response to it.
Order. I just want to remind the member for Clare Digby that the questions be directed through the chair and not refer to the minister by name. The Honourable Member for Clare Digby.
Mr. Speaker, my apologies. Mr. Speaker, the lobster industry in Nova Scotia is a $1 billion industry engaging upwards of 13,000 people from Yarmouth to Cape Breton. Mr. Speaker, yesterday a historic lobster summit was held, bringing together three maritime fisheries ministers and more than 200 fishermen, processors, and industry experts to discuss the four key recommendations outlined in the Maritime Lobster Panel report released last fall. Mr. Speaker, will the Minister of Fisheries and Aquaculture provide the House with an update on the importance of the summit and the industry? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Minister of Agriculture, Fisheries and Aquaculture.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm only too pleased to do that. It is an historic day today. Today we had the three Atlantic fisheries ministers and also the federal minister working cooperatively towards moving the lobster industry to a sustainable, profitable industry in Nova Scotia and indeed in Atlantic Canada. It has been an historic day, and as we continue to work together and to try to evolve these industries into a profitable industry from the wharf right through to the people that sell the lobsters in an international market. Indeed, we have to move forward and grow the economy in the lobster industry as we do in the fishing industry and the other industries that represent. So it's a pleasure to see this happening. It's a wonderful relationship we've struck with the other two provincial governments and the federal government, and it is historic. In the past, there hasn't been that type of cooperation. I'm very proud to say that our government is encouraging that, and we'll move forward to make sure that our industries are profitable now and in the future. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Kings North.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Fisheries and Aquaculture. And again, I would commend the Canadian Lobster Value Recovery Summit for meeting during such inclement weather in the last 2 days. I know those have been very important meetings and have had a number of results. The Maritime Lobster Panel report that was presented 4 months ago had a number of recommendations, I believe 33 recommendations. Can the minister provide an update on where we are with those 33 recommendations in that report?
Honourable Minister of Fisheries.
Thank you very much. It would take a lot longer than we have today and tomorrow and next week to answer all those 33 requirements. But we are making progress in the industry. We are moving forward. We have been working with the industry sector. We have many challenges, as all my colleagues in this legislature would know, that represent rural fishing communities. We are making progress. We will continue to work with the industry at all levels and to ensure that we have those in place. And it's extremely important that we do. This is the most important employer in the whole province, the fishing industry, and a lot of people don't realize that. We've exceeded $1 billion in export sales this year alone, and we employ roughly 13,500 people directly, but over 22,000 people in the province, by far the largest employer in the province.
The Honourable Member for Kings North on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I would like to thank the Minister of Fisheries and Aquaculture for that answer. Mr. Speaker, there are seven recommendations in that are due within the first 6 months of 2014, and one of those is that the government immediately begin to work necessary to ensure proper legislation is prepared and ready when the industry decides to proceed with the approach. My question to the minister is, will the minister be tabling legislation in this session to support the changes the industry wants to make?
Honourable Minister of Fisheries.
We will not be presenting legislation this session of the legislature around that issue. Fortunately, we do not have to do that. We can do it by regulation.
The Honourable Member for Kings North on his final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I know that one of the results that came out of the summit in the last 2 days was an endorsement of the levy. I would like to ask the minister, would the minister be providing regulations to see that the levy is put in place as the industry has indicated that it wants?
The Honourable Minister of Fisheries.
The answer to that question is yes, but first we want to consult with the industry more before we do that. It's going to be not only Nova Scotia that does this, it's going to be Prince Edward Island and New Brunswick as well. And we're working cooperatively with the other two provinces, as we will with the federal government, to ensure that we can put a levy in place that will market Nova Scotia, not only just Nova Scotia lobster, but a Canadian brand lobster that will demand a lot higher price than we get today, ultimately putting more money on the wharves and the hands of fishermen in Nova Scotia, as well as in the processors and everyone in between. So it's important that we do this, important we do this in an orderly manner, and I'm looking forward to the consultation we're going to have with industry. But at the end of the day, we're going to implement that.
The Honourable Member for Pictou Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is through you to the Minister of Service, Nova Scotia Municipal Relations. One of the goals of the Ivany Commission was to reform municipal government and regional service structures. The Commission said the government should initiate a comprehensive review of municipal government structures with an eye to improving efficiency, cost effectiveness, and community engagement. My question to the Minister, does the Minister agree with this Ivany goal?
The Honourable Minister of Service, Nova Scotia Municipal Relations.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Certainly, the content of the Ivany report is a valid document and a document that we support. The component around municipal reform is first and foremost in my mind and the staff in our department. And over the past number of weeks, we've worked vigorously with a number of municipalities to pursue that very option.
The Honourable Member for Pictou Centre on his first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. At 8:19 p.m. Tuesday, under the cover of darkness on the eve of a storm, the Minister issued a press release, which I will table, saying the Liberal government will not contribute to a study on a regional governance model in Pictou County. Despite the Minister's anticipated commitment to the Ivany goals, he threw up his hands and walked away rather than to roll up his sleeves and work to improve the services for the people of Pictou County. Why won't the Minister lead the way to a solution for Pictou County residents rather than walking away when the going gets tough?
The Honourable Minister of Service, Nova Scotia Municipal Relations.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I value the question from my colleague. I actually traveled to Pictou County on the eve of the storm and spent a couple of hours with the elected officials, mayors, wardens, and CAOs. And I shared the findings of our discussions of 2 weeks previous. And I want to assure my colleague that this government is taking the lead in municipal reform, and I'll be back to Pictou County next week to further discussions with municipalities who want to pursue another model of government.
The Honourable Member for Pictou Centre on his final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Mayor of the town of Pictou estimates that the town has the economic resources to survive 3 to 5 years. Westville is running a deficit as the 2013-14 budget year winds to a close. Meanwhile, the Minister seems to be showing up for some meetings, but also taking a hands-off approach to municipal reform in Pictou County. Why is he prepared to watch communities that need the leadership now, not next year or the year after, while communities are dissolving, instead of working towards solutions immediately?
The Honourable Minister of Service, Nova Scotia Municipal Relations.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. That's exactly what this government is doing, and we continue through our travels to engage our municipal colleagues and to openly discuss and support their initiatives. We'll continue to do that, and as I said, we'll be back in Pictou County next week.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question through you is to the Minister of Finance. Mr. Speaker, under the previous government, the practice of March Madness, or unplanned year-end spending, was abolished. As a former Minister of Finance was fond of saying, Mr. Speaker, a penny saved should be a penny saved. My question for the Minister of Finance. Sorry, Mr. Speaker, I thought the Minister of Natural Resources had a question he wanted to ask. Did he?
Order, please. Please proceed with your question. Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Mr. Speaker, my question for the Minister of Finance is this. What is her government's official position on March Madness with respect to year-end spending?
The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question that's been asked by the member opposite. In fact, when the previous government had a program to sort of shine a spotlight on March Madness and try and put an end to it, I thought that was the right thing to do, and about a month ago I did send a letter out to my cabinet colleagues and to those departments saying that I thought we should continue to be very alert to that. Thank you.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party on her first supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and that's a very good minister, Mr. Speaker, who would continue that initiative that was quite successful. So my question to the minister is this. Is she aware of whether or not her directive to her colleagues in throughout the cabinet has been followed or not, Mr. Speaker?
The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I think, as the member would know, certainly in the last month and 6 weeks and more, we've been doing intensive discussions with each of the departments about spending. And anything above a certain amount comes back to Treasury Board for approval, even outside of the budget discussions that we've been having. So, to the best of my knowledge, the departments are well aware of the need to conserve. That doesn't mean spending stops in March, and I think the minister would be aware of that, that there's still some need for spending, that items arise that may not have been foreseen. But it means that there's scrutiny about that. Thank you.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party on her final supplementary. No go. The Honourable Member for Inverness.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Environment. Last fall, I was contacted by farmers in Inverness County who use wood ash from the Point Tupper biomass plant to fertilize their fields. It's a low-cost alternative to fertilize. It improves crop yields, and it eliminates having to dump it in a landfill. Now, the Canadian Food Inspection Agency maintains that it is safe for use, and I understood at the time that this government agreed. However, I'm understanding now that the government is saying no to it. Why not allow the farmers to make good use of this resource?
The Honourable Minister of the Environment.
I do recall the scenario that played out in the fall with respect to the wood ash, Mr. Speaker. What actually did take place is that there were some changes in the regulatory body in terms that are governing the components that make up that wood ash. There were some concerns about some of the components that make up some of the heavy metal components in that output and laying that out in our fields. The position taken in the fall was that we had inconclusive information, and we allowed the product to continue until we had conclusive information. The information has been clarified, and a new position has been taken. And I would refer probably potentially Minister of Agriculture may have more to add if you have further questions about the response that they're being taken in the agricultural space to that decision.
The Honourable Member for Inverness on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, as I understand, all agricultural products that are sold and applied to fertilized fields have to meet the Canadian Food Inspection Agency standards, and all other provinces are following these standards. The fact that we are using a different standard here now is hurting the business case for farming operations right across the province. And the Canadian Federation of, or the Canadian, the CFIA agrees that the ash is safe and beneficial. Our farmers want to use it. Why not let them use it, Mr. Speaker?
The Honourable Minister of the Environment.
In the case of the particular ash product here in the province of Nova Scotia, it has not been certified by the federal agency. In fact, what the Department of Environment is regulating is a waste product from the facility producing the ash. And in fact, we do have different regulations for managing waste products, and those are the regulations that my department puts in place. The product that's in question has not been certified by the federal government, as indicated. If it was, it would perhaps raise a different set of questions.
Honourable member for Inverness on his final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I understand it's now being classified as a Class B fertilizer, and I think the government needs to be careful because I also understand that that lime is considered a Class B fertilizer, and in effect, they may be suggesting that the agricultural community cannot use lime. So, Mr. Speaker, there have been decades of research to show the value and safety of wood ash to agriculture. Other provinces and states have even given environmental awards for wood ash programs. And not only has this program improved soil pH, but it's also reduced our reliance on fossil fuel fertilizers. Will the minister reconsider his decision?
Order, please. Time allotted for oral questions to the ministers has expired. Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In light of the fact that this is our first day of the spring session and in light of the very productive fall session that we had, there is currently no government business on the order paper. As a result of that, that concludes the government's business for today. Mr. Speaker, we will meet tomorrow, Friday, from the hours of 9 a.m. Till 1 p.m. And during that time, after the orders of the day under government business, we will be calling second reading of bills number 32, 33, and 34, which were all introduced today. So with that, Mr. Speaker, I would move that the House do now rise to meet again tomorrow from the hours of 9 a.m. till 1 p.m.
The motion is that the House rise to meet again tomorrow, March 28th, between the hours of 9 a.m. and 1 p.m. Would those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. We stand adjourned until 9 a.m. tomorrow, right after breakfast. We've now reached the moment of interruption. And the adjournment notice was submitted by the Honourable House, Government House Leader. We'll now move on to late debate. And the topic is, therefore, be it resolved that the Liberal government's mishandling of the negotiations with nurses at Capital Health will cause the cancellation of important tests and procedures and is putting patient safety at risk. The Honourable Member for Pictou Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, Capital Health began ramping down their services today to prepare for a possible strike. They reported their emergency services plan, which shows just how significant the cutbacks will be. The government cannot stand idly by while real Nova Scotians have their health care put in jeopardy due to a labour dispute. People need to know their health care is going to be there when they need it. Nurses are vital to our health care system, and the care they provide is second to none. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotians deserve better than this. The high-quality care our nurses offer is something they come to expect of our health care system. People across the province would agree that nurses' work is incredibly hard, and they may have an excellent point regarding workloads and staffing in our wards. It is up to the government, Mr. Speaker, who ultimately oversees the hospitals to make sure they are properly staffed. Real Nova Scotians are going to be impacted by the cutback in health services. And we all know people that have been impacted. These people are afraid, and so am I. Mr. Speaker, starting today, the inpatient detox unit will close. There will be no nurses in the hematology clinic. There will be no eye surgeries. And patients admitted to the hospital will be put on huge, long waiting lists. It's more than 50% of the beds are closing. Patients who travel to Nova Scotia to be treated at our renowned QE2 Health Science Center have already been transferred back to Prince Edward Island. Patients from Oda Province who were scheduled to have cardiac surgeries performed here are already being rerouted. Capital Health has reported that the East Coast Forensic Hospital will have staffing levels they have deemed unsafe. Mr. Speaker, this is unacceptable. Nova Scotians cannot stand by while important services like these become unavailable. They deserve better than that. Mr. Speaker, the government has done nothing but add overheated rhetoric to this problem, which does not do anything to help protect patients. The government has made the situation worse by antagonizing nurses and showing a lack of leadership. This government needs to guarantee Nova Scotians will have access to care or access to health care they can rely on. Cooler heads must prevail to protect patients. In closing, Mr. Speaker, the government should reflect on how dangerous this situation could get, make sure nurses are heard and respected. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Sorry about that, my error. The Honourable Minister of Health.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and pleased to have an opportunity today to speak to a very important issue that is at hand. At hand in, of course, the capital district of the province. First of all, I think all of us in the province at one time or another have had contact with a nurse in one of our hospitals, our healthcare centers, nursing homes, public health, through our school system. And so I think, you know, it's very important to state clearly and categorically that the work of nurses is critical to providing top quality health care in our province. They are well trained, many years of collective experience, and in fact a lot of very specialized training that is required, especially for a number of nurses that provide and assist with the tertiary level care that is provided at the QE2. I think it's very important, however, to set a little bit of context in that, you know, nurses are part of a team, and that today in our healthcare system, we know that scopes of practice have changed really fairly dramatically over a couple of decades. And so there's a great number of support staff. There are new technologies that assist nurses in their work. And having the right complement of all of the professionals, as much of the modern technology and support certainly aids in the flow of work of our nurses. We also need to be cognizant of the fact that, you know, this is a Capital Health and NSGEU issue. The work in 9 of our 10 districts will go on. And in fact, as part of the contingency plan, some of the nine districts are prepared to take patients back, prepared to assist patients in terms of making sure that they get the appropriate service that they require. So it is indeed, fortunate that we do have that ability to rely on, again, other districts to support, in the event of a strike, that patients and Nova Scotians can be assured that they will have access. Does it mean that there will be, a slowdown in services? That's pretty obvious. We don't have the normal complement of nurses at their in their units and on their floors. However, we hope that if there is a strike, that the emergency provisions that are in the current contract will make sure that those that are in need of emergency care, urgent care, obviously dialysis, these areas that that are required on a very regular basis. Somebody who is in chemotherapy, radiation. We certainly don't want to see any disruptions that are taking place. I've put a lot of faith in the process of reaching what we would hope is a fair and equitable settlement. And we know that sometimes it may be not about staffing ratios, it may be about responsiveness to acuity levels, to scheduling. And I know a new program did provide in early days some challenges, but it is my understanding that that it is working much better and making the kind of adjustments that are required. A hospital, and especially a place like the QE2 in particular, is a very, very dynamic institution that requires a great deal of flexibility as well in terms of having the right number of nurses, the nursing experience level, and specialized skills that are required. And we all realize that there, in fact, may be some times when that may not be quite to the level. But we know that Capital Health Administration, nurse managers work diligently to make sure that in fact, is in place on a daily basis and responds to the varied needs. I think it's important to point out at this time that, with having two unions in the province, we have one with over 5,000 nurses that are also very cognizant of the fact of having the right number of nurses, the right complement at a given time, and I understand that the language of the contract signed in October provides that kind of flexibility that will, in fact, allow them to deal with higher levels of workload. Also, if we have seasonal variations that come along, especially due to flu, sometimes, again, there can be higher levels of patients that are receiving chemotherapy and so forth. So the Nova Scotia Nurses Union was the first of the Atlantic provinces to achieve language that allows for that kind of important adjustment without having to appeal and without having to go through any rigorous process in order to get the right number of nurses that are required on a given basis. So I think that is great progress. I think in terms of the mandatory nurse-patient ratios, I think it takes away, this is my perspective, that it does take away some of the flexibility and in fact can have, I think, even some negative impacts on the healthcare system as hospitals in California experienced when they brought in mandatory nurse-to-patient ratios. In fact, on my tour, I had a couple, husband and wife nursing team, who gave me their personal account of having been in a California hospital when nurse-patient ratios came in. And when they came in, they, you know, they applauded. They obviously said, this is a good day, that we're going to have an extra nurse, an extra pair of hands, that kind of professionalism that, in fact, will allow us to hopefully do a higher quality of job. However, you know, that was fine. Worked for about, 6 months. The next year, of course, they're dealing with the same budget. And this was right across hospitals in California. And out the door started going an LPN, clerical staff, night watchman, reduced hours of pharmacist. You've got so many dollars to run the institution. And they found that in order to keep the nurse ratios that had been mandated, they were not able to keep the complement the complement of complete staff that they're required. And I think if we leave it to healthcare administrators to collaborate to develop a viable and sustainable formula for what is best on a given floor, in a given day, in a given week, that kind of professionalism will come through. It does not need the kind of strict nurse-patient ratios. We can go in most hospitals during summertime when, in fact, we know that surgeons take holidays as well. And there may not be as many surgeries, maybe not as many procedures going on, and we need flexibility in the system, and I believe that can be achieved without that current outstanding issue. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I'd like to thank the official opposition for bringing forward this resolution so we can have a bit of a debate here at, I think, a very important time on a very important topic. You know, there's this kind of cliche that you often hear, but cliches come from, you know, a reality, I guess, in some ways. They're generally based on fact, and it's that nurses are the backbone of the healthcare system. And I would say that as someone who is a healthcare professional, a social worker, and who very much values the team approach in healthcare, it would be a grave mistake on anyone's part to think that other members of a healthcare team in any way, shape, or form are the same as a nurse or can substitute in terms of the work that nurses do. You know, I'm physiotherapists, OTs, social workers, pharmacists. We all have our roles to play in the healthcare system. But very few of us work 24/7 at the bedside, providing that hands-on care when people are critically ill and in need of monitoring in terms of what the physician has prescribed and the monitoring of the vital signs, which are so absolutely critical in an acute care facility or indeed in a tertiary care facility. So make no mistake about this, Mr. Speaker. If nurses in this province, experienced nurses and new nurses, but I'm hearing from nurses that have been in the system for 25, 28, and 30 years, make no mistake if those nurses are saying that the system is broken in terms of overload, workplace overload, and that it's putting them under an enormous amount of stress and de-stress in terms of the care that they're able to provide, then Houston, we have a problem, and we need to be listening to that problem, and we need to be responding to that problem. And I think minimizing the problem, and I've heard the Minister of Health, and I've heard the CEO from the Capital District Health Authority talk about the team, and I'm all for team in the healthcare field, but let's be crystal clear. If nurses are calling in sick, and they're working shorthanded, and they're feeling stressed, and they're concerned about the kind of care that patients are receiving, then we all should be very, very, very concerned about that. Mr. Speaker, I think pretty much everybody practically has a nurse in their family. My grandmother was a nurse, and I look up and down my street. I have on my street these neighbors that are just wonderful, wonderful women who work in the nursing profession. Young woman who works in the ER at the IWK, and a woman who is probably more my age, who after a very long period of time in the healthcare field, the stress and the strain of doing that work affected her own health to the point that she was unable to be a nurse anymore. And so I see the kind of passion that my young neighbor brings to her profession. And I've observed the passion that my older neighbor has brought to her profession. And I see the end result of working in this field for many, many years, and the cost that that can have, the personal toll it will take on nurses. We need to be very careful about how we address this issue. This is a serious issue. It needs to be taken seriously. It needs to be treated with the kind of attention that we would give to any workplace where people are telling us that the conditions are not good conditions under which to perform their work. And the minister talked about California and the fact that mandatory ratios did not work in California. And I, you know, Mr. Speaker, I have no views on mandatory ratios. I'm not a nurse. I'm not somebody who works on the front lines. I'm not a nurse manager. I have no skills in terms of planning the delivery of health care in an acute care situation. But, you know, what I do know something about is about health care and about health care in different parts of the world. And I'll tell you, if there's one state in the U.S., which I would not go to, as a matter of fact, to look for practice to transport into our country necessarily. But let me tell you, if there was a state that I wouldn't look at, it would be the state of California. And anybody who has spent any time reading about not just health care in the United States, but police services and fire services and public services more generally would not look at the state of California. The state of California has, in their preoccupation to not have any public services, have entered into a kind of public policy there that has robbed citizens of that state of any quality public services whatsoever. And so I don't think it's the best reference point for us to look at in terms of whether mandatory nurse-patient ratios are something that can succeed or not. Surely, with all of the resources that the government has available to it, it can look further than the state of California. The final point, Mr. Speaker, and I'm not sure how much time I have left, but the final point I would say is how important it is for us to encourage the parties to get back to the table and reach a negotiated settlement here. And the deep concern I have that the government has botched this and has made it less likely that a negotiated settlement is possible. And the reason for that is the way this government dealt with the healthcare workers. You know, it doesn't give me confidence that the employer in the Capital District went to the table knowing that that's where a solution had to be reached. If they think they have a government that is going to whip in to the House of Assembly with essential services legislation and bring the hammer down on healthcare workers, why in the world would they have to bargain at the bargaining table and try to find a solution to the problems that the nurses have brought to their attention? And that's the problem here, Mr. Speaker, that I think we have seen ourselves boxed into this situation now that is very difficult to get out of. And to get out of it will require leadership from the Premier. Leadership from the Premier on this. Not threats, not sitting back and just letting the clock tick. This requires leadership and involvement from the Premier. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I want to thank all the members who participated in the adjournment debate this afternoon. The House now stands adjourned till 9 a.m. tomorrow morning.